Hey everyone, and welcome to today's webinar hosted by CauseVox. I want to start today a little bit differently by telling you three stories. This is Corinne. Her son Patrick was actually diagnosed with autism in 2008 at the age of 18 months. To keep it lightly, things were tough for Patrick, for Corinne, and their family. And then in 2012, she found encouragement in a community group that provided support and education. This was huge and helped Corinne support Patrick well and her family. And last year, as Patrick was on the verge of turning 10, Corinne wanted to do more. And she's sharing her story, Patrick's story, as a way to encourage others and raise funding to expand the hope-bringing programs that Corinne discovered in 2012. And this is Chris and his son, Will. In 2017, they traveled together to Zambia as a way to connect further through a shared passion. However, this wasn't simply a bonding trip. Chris and Will together were able to inspire friends, family, and colleagues to offer new opportunities for 263 people in rural communities in Zambia. And this is David. He's an advocate for rights for every single LGBTQ person and a board member at GLAAD. And he was able to act on purpose and leverage their network to inspire 24 other people to get behind this cause too. So together, Corinne, Chris, and Will, and David each tapped their passion, experiences, and connections to make a significant impact on some of the most important causes in our world today, similar to how you're working on causes really important today. And this is truly incredible. However, this didn't happen by chance, luck, or simply an anomaly. So how did it happen? How did Corinne and Chris and Will and David raise so much awareness, funding, and help acquire new donors for these causes? How did that happen? Well, it happened because the do-gooders in the trenches at these three nonprofits understood something about today's supporter. That today's supporter, as we're living in the connected economy, want to be a part of something, not merely give to it. And not only that, they understood and implemented a framework to successfully embed this idea of ensuring people felt like they were joining something, becoming a part of something, and not merely just giving to something. They embedded this into their messaging and their fundraising strategy, because they know that the world we live in today has fundamentally shifted, and the world you're fundraising in has fundamentally shifted. And we kind of sum that up and say, we're living in the connected economy, where access to information is now ubiquitous, resulting in kind of a shift of power from organizations to individuals. We saw this in how someone like Corinne, who was deeply impacted in her family by something, but then was supported by an organization that reached out to her and provided her an opportunity to connect with like-minded individuals, people that could support her, that could understand her, but then also created a platform where she could leverage not only her finances, but her story, her influence, to amplify the reach of that organization's message and ultimately raise more money for them so that they could move their mission forward. Additionally, we're living in an age where rapid adoption of mobile means anyone can reach anyone, anywhere, at any time. People like Chris and Will can reach out to colleagues. Will could reach out to friends through mobile and allow them to give and connect to this idea that they wanted to help individuals in impoverished communities in rural Zambia with the opportunity to just move, to move more seamlessly through providing mobility to them, which increases their quality of life and opportunity that they have. And then ultimately, technology has and continues to transform and connect all aspects of our lives. Individuals like David, who have a network through their professional commitments, have a network of people that they've engaged with over the years. And now he can take that network and use his influence to amplify a cause, a message, good in our world, and reach out to his community, invite them and inspire them to be a part of the change as well. These are some of the incredible opportunities that you and your organization have as a part of the connected economy. People are digital first, relationship driven, and ultimately it gives you the opportunity to see your supporters as more than a number on a spreadsheet or a dollar increase or as an account that gave you $473 last year. These are the shifts that are happening in our world because people like Corinne and Will and Chris and David have an incredible opportunity to use their influence, not just their money, to really make a huge difference and help move those organizations' missions forward. And you have people like Corinne and Will and Chris in your organization. And ultimately, these supporters are hyper-connected. They live inside personal feeds and discover and support causes recommended by their friends. And again, they desire to be a part of the change, not merely give to it. And like we said, these three organizations were able to create an environment, very different organizations, very different size organizations, but they were able to create an environment and a fundraising strategy that really captured these ideas of today's connected economy. But how do they do it? And this is kind of bringing us into today's presentation. Like, how did they create an environment, very different organization, very different causes, where they could successfully support people to do fundraising on their behalf, where Corinne could raise money by using her story for the organization, or Chris and Will could use their network and their influence and their shared passion to raise money for their organization, or David, who could use his lifelong work and network to really amplify a cause and a change in our world that he really wants to see happen and could share that and ultimately bring others and inspire others along the way. What did they do? And so this leads us to today's presentation. I wanted to leave that as an intro because I think it's important to see that this is happening all around us. Maybe your organization's already tapping into this and you've seen stories like Corinne in your own organization. You have people like David who are advocating for your cause. Or as what we found out in the intro when I was asking some questions to our audience today, many of you haven't even explored this. But I hope to set kind of a groundwork that this is a huge opportunity for your organization and one that is continuing to grow as we move into 2019. And what we've tried to do here at CauseVox, you know, a leading online fundraising platform, where we have the opportunity to really work alongside individuals like the ones you saw at TACA, at World Bicycle Relief, at GLAAD, and thousands of other organizations, we have the opportunity to look at 1,000+ campaigns raising millions and really analyze and interview and kind of pull out qualitative insights of how do you actually replicate this in your organization? How do you move from dabbling in peer-to-peer to scaling? How do you really use peer-to-peer fundraising effectively to raise more, to move your mission forward? And so for the next 25, 30 minutes, that's what we're going to dig on, is how you can actually replicate this type of model at your organization. And what are the foundation, what are the building blocks that are going to help you do just that? And so since we're going to spend some time together, I think it's only appropriate that you understand and know a little bit more about me. And so my name is Noah Barnett. I run marketing here at CauseVox. But first and foremost, I'm a husband and a father to three sons. These are my three boys here on the screen. The one on the far left is most like me, and his name is also Noah, so it's only fitting. Like I mentioned, I also run marketing at CauseVox, which is a leading online fundraising platform that really equips nonprofits like yours with everything you need, the software, best practices like we're sharing today, and even hands-on help from our experienced team of fundraising advisors who come along, individuals that are trying to think well about peer-to-peer fundraising and they're looking to implement this in a variety of different ways. And so we come alongside them and help them do that. Again, providing that fundraising platform that really helps you amplify your reach, acquire new donors, and raise more money. It's purposely simple, it's designed for you, and ultimately we accompany that with a lot of hands-on help and support. And this platform gives us a great opportunity because we have organizations using us for all sorts of fundraising initiatives, whether it's their online giving, monthly giving, recurring giving programs, creating fundraising sites, whether it's for a capital campaign, an annual fund, a giving day like Giving Tuesday, or even a capital project. This also includes crowdfunding opportunities, personal fundraising pages, and then even peer-to-peer registration where people are doing walkathon, race-a-thon, polar plunges, beard challenges, whatever it is, they're using our platform to do that. And so this gives us great insights into how organizations in today's connected economy are really raising millions through their community. And so the backbone of today's presentation is built on this. What we did was we took a look at over 2,500 peer-to-peer campaigns that collectively have over 84,000 personal fundraising pages. So this means 2,500 campaigns, 84,000, almost 85,000 individual pages as part of those campaigns. So it's an incredible scale and really an opportunity that we have to really observe these and analyze these. And like I mentioned, these aren't just singular peer-to-peer type deals where maybe what you've imagined peer-to-peer is like a giving day where people go out and raise money, or maybe you see peer-to-peer as a race or a walk. How we really looked at this is we see peer-to-peer fundraising and really this overall umbrella that we call community-driven fundraising, because it's really not just peer-to-peer, but it's this idea of how are you leveraging your community's voice to help amplify your message, acquire new donors, and ultimately raise more to move your mission forward. And so we looked at a large range of different types of initiatives that are doing just this, doing just exactly what I shared at the beginning of our presentation, what Corinne, what Chris and Will were doing, and what David were doing. We looked at big organizations, we looked at small organizations, we looked at organizations that aren't even nonprofits, but they have a purpose-driven approach to what they're doing, and they're helping people gain access regaining access to sites. We also looked at events like Postpartum Support International's Climb Out of Darkness, where they do walkathons around the country with almost 2,000 participants, which is a massive scale. But we also took a step back and looked at smaller events like the She Hero Walk that N Street Village does in DC, where they invite individuals to come alongside them and raise money, but also walk in the community to really showcase the work and change that N Street Village is having in their community and really giving a voice to that. We also looked at co-marketing efforts where organizations are partnering with other entities to really tap into their audience, like World Help does, where they partner with Leading and Loving It, which is a large scale women's conference, where Leading and Loving It invites their participants to go out and raise money on behalf of a specific cause that World Help's supporting. But they're able to do this through peer-to-peer. All of these are CauseVox customers. So CauseVox is helping them power all of these efforts. But we're able to look at these types of things. So peer-to-peer is really, really broad. And it's not just here domestically. We're based here in the US. So a lot of our customers are from the US or from Canada. But we also have a larger scale than that, where we have some view into how others around the world are also leveraging peer-to-peer. And I give all this background because this is really kind of the foundation of where some of these insights are coming from. We've worked on this for over about 2 years now, and we continue to iterate on this idea because we really wanted to create a blueprint. Like CauseVox's goal is to help good flourish in the world. And we do that through a lot of different ways, including our online fundraising software. But we wanted to be able to give you a blueprint, a plan that you could really use as a foundation to tap into community-driven fundraising. And so for the next 15 or 20 minutes, I'm gonna give you a preview of that. And if you're interested in diving even further into this, we recently did a summit a couple weeks ago where we talked for 6 hours all about community-driven fundraising. We had panels, we had experts, we had nonprofit leaders break down their campaigns. And so it was a 6-hour free virtual training that I'm going to send you to or send you access to after today's presentation. So whether you got to attend that or not, I want to make sure that after today's presentation, you don't just have the sparks, but you have the backbone to really think well about how you and your nonprofit can use community-driven fundraising to really scale up your impact in 2019, but more importantly, get on the front end of a growth curve where this type of fundraising is really the future of fundraising. And so we see that as we look at 2018, 2019, and beyond 2020, this idea of fundraising is really going to become more and more important in your organizations because the environment we live in is changing, but also today's supporter is demanding more. And so what we've done to really kind of simplify our research and kind of commentary that we've really dug into over the past few months and even longer than that, almost 18 months to 2 years now, is bucketed the ideas into three, or put the ideas into three buckets to really help kind of simplify some of these ideas. And so what we're going to share is that there's clear threads that run through each successful campaign. When we look at TACA, who was the organization that Corinne was fundraising for, or Chris and Will, who were fundraising for World Bicycle Relief, or David, who was fundraising for GLAAD and, you know, 84,000 other people that we looked at, there are clear threads that run through each successful campaign. And they're bucketed into three fundamental truths. So the organizations that are successful at community-driven fundraising incorporate these three truths into their fundraising plan and ultimately lead to how they encourage people to be a part of peer-to-peer fundraising initiatives on behalf of their organization. And so what I'm gonna do is share the three buckets, and then I'm gonna actually break down each bucket even further and provide some examples and some commentary on that. So let's go. The first bucket, or the first fundamental truth that organizations that are successful at community-driven fundraising or peer-to-peer is that they focus on this idea that they want to inspire people to become a supporter of their organization or to become an advocate for their organization. They don't want to guilt people into supporting their organization. They understand that if they're going to effectively build a community of advocates that are going to go out and inspire others, those people cannot be guilted into becoming a supporter and then convinced, which is the next thing, into becoming an advocate. They really have to be inspired. And then the next truth is that they have to be activated, not convinced. And so when we talk to new organizations that are exploring peer-to-peer fundraising, we hear this phrase too often. I want to do peer-to-peer. It seems super valuable. I want to find the Corinnes and Davids in my organization. I want to do that. But how am I supposed to convince them to fundraise for us? Fundraising is hard. Like, I don't even like fundraising that much. How are we going to convince people to fundraise for us? And again, it goes back to these are fundamental truths that we tell ourselves that impact how we structure our strategy, how we think about our fundraising campaigns. So the organizations that are successful with community-driven fundraising, really getting people to engage with peer-to-peer, start with the idea that they want to activate people, not convince them. And the key framing of activate is that it acknowledges that there's already intent or capabilities there. Your organization is just providing a platform to be able to do that. Corinne, who was going through this experience with her son and trying to support her son and her family as well as she could, came upon an organization that was providing services. But ultimately, that then was part of Corinne's story. Or the organization was successful in really activating Corinne was they provided an opportunity for her to share her story and to be a part of, not merely give to, their organization's efforts, ultimately helping them expand and find the next Corinne and serve her and be a part of her story, which they hope to activate in the future as well. So this idea of activation versus convincing is crucial to success and peer-to-peer. These are fundamental truths, is that we are going to lead in and see people as having potential or desire to be a part of, And it's our job as an organization to invite them or create opportunities to activate that potential. In today's connected economy, people don't just have money to give, but their influence has exponentially greater value in the connected economy that they can contribute and give to your organization. So the last bucket or the last truth that a lot of the organizations that we looked at and the common threads that we saw, which I think is actually the most difficult one, and I'll kind of talk through that a little bit more later as we dive deeper into these buckets. This idea that they believe that because they're inviting people to be a part of their organization's effort, they don't see their supporters as giving to their organization. They see them as partners coming in and actually being a part of the change that they're making. And whether that's a small community school where believes that a certain type of education, like a Montessori school, like here in my local city, like they're a nonprofit, but they believe that their supporters that are coming into that believe that this type of education is going to create the best opportunities for children. And so when people support that, they're not just helping the school survive or paying the teachers' salaries, but they're coming together as part of this movement that they're creating. Or it could be a large scale organization where I spent 6.5 years where we were providing this idea of helping children and their communities really thrive and flourish. And we did that through a lot of different ways by providing healthcare, and clean water and basic necessities like food and clothing, housing, shelter, hospitals, all those types of things, schooling. You're really focused on this idea that when people bought in, we wanted to rally them together as supporters. And that's what helped us in my personal experience, because I've implemented this program at a nonprofit before. We were able to really see how our community was able to help us grow and raise, I think they've raised millions of dollars now over the course of a few years on how this works and how they can do this well. But on the flip side, there's this idea that a lot of times it's like, how do we control the message? Like peer-to-peer is scary because we don't really want people to go out and like say something bad about our organization. We're really sensitive to that. And I think it's, again, a false dilemma where it's like, okay, well, we want people to go out, but we want to control our message. And we don't want them to go out and say something stupid or say the wrong thing or tell somebody that we do something that maybe we don't, or just misrepresent our organization. It's not a control or freedom, but there's this idea of rally, which is what we leaned on, where you're not trying to control the message, but you're trying to encourage and guide, provide guardrails, provide resources, equip and train people to be effective at fundraising on your behalf, inspiring others to become supporters of your organization's efforts. So these three buckets of truth. So we had inspire over guilt, activate over convince, and rally over control. These are the backbone beliefs that an organization has to have first to be successful at community-driven fundraising. And we see this run through deep, small, large, global, local cause. Doesn't matter. These are the things that these organizations have had, which allow them to successfully grow a community of advocates that are inspiring others to support those causes and organizations. And so let's dig into this. So we've actually created this like framework called community-driven fundraising. Based on this research. So this idea that you actually inspire people from your community to become supporters, and that it's your job as a nonprofit to activate them, empower them to act, identify influencers, and really make it easy. And then rallying fundraisers to be advocates. You want to equip them well, you want to keep momentum, and you want to celebrate often. And ultimately, this allows your advocates to inspire others to become supporters. And so naturally, this is an organic word of mouth program that really grows on itself. I'll share some examples on how organizations have actually seen that kind of step ladder type growth when they think differently about how they engage with their supporters and have adopted this idea of community-driven fundraising and seen incredible results. And ultimately, which is what I hope all of us on this presentation are focused on, is that enabled them to really move their mission forward, to make a bigger dent in the work that they were doing, and they could invest more in impact. So let's dig into each of these buckets, and then we'll wrap up with some questions. So if you have questions or some thinking around these, as I'm going through this, don't feel like you have to wait till the end. Drop those in the chat pane, or the questions box, and we'll get to those as much as we can as we push through the rest of these insights and lessons that we want to share with you. So feel free to drop those in. So the first bucket we talked about was inspiration over guilt. And I love this quote, and I've shared it often. So if you've been to a webinar with us here at CauseVox previously, where we're talking about online fundraising or peer-to-peer fundraising or community-driven fundraising, you've heard this quote. But I think it's so important, I want to repeat it as much as possible because I think it sums up what our job as a fundraiser is when we go out and represent our organization, whether it's to a crowd or to an individual, through social, through an email, or through a direct mail piece. And ultimately, it goes like this. We as fundraisers have to devise a means of making known the facts of your organization, the backbone of why your organization matters, in such a way as to touch the imagination of the world. This idea of inspiration. The world is not ungenerous, but unimaginative and very busy. And to give some legs to this, because sometimes this is so abstract that people are like, great, I get it, I believe it, but what the heck does that mean? Like, what are you talking about? And so I'll give you an example of how I've seen this firsthand at a nonprofit. So I worked at an international relief nonprofit for a little over 6 years. And one of the things that we did was we did so many things that it was really hard to nail down or kind of focus in our messaging. And so we struggled to communicate really well or kind of present in a variety of different ways all the work that we did without over-explaining or kind of showcasing all the impact. You know, we helped millions of people every single year, but no one really cares whether you help millions of people or not. They want to kind of have something that they can connect with. We hear numbers and stats all the time, and it's hard for us kind of even to really wrap our minds around that. And so a couple years into my time there, I was already engaged in the organization. I was working really hard. I was working on some child development programs. Someone said this: you provide education, you provide schooling, you provide supplies, you provide food and shelter, clean water, you provide love and caring people, but do you know what you're really doing? We're in the business of helping or giving kids the opportunity to dream again. We're in the dream-making business because we know based on stats that education, basic necessities, and some of this core idea of support and love, that gives people to dream about a new possibility, a new future. So we're in the dream-making business. That engulfed me because that touched the imagination of me, which then I was able to communicate really well to people. This idea that we're in the dream-making business. We want to create opportunities so kids can dream again. And even though we did a ton of other stuff and we helped millions of people, that idea of helping a single kid or a single mom dream again about what could be versus what was an incredible way that we really engaged people in our organization's mission. And you may have a similar story. You may have a similar impact. It takes teasing it out in a way that touches people, the imagination, because people aren't ungenerous. They're just unimaginative and very busy, especially in today's connected economy. And so how do you actually do that? So the first step is that the first peer-to-peer tactic that I'm gonna leave with you outside of these three buckets is that you want to highlight stories, not stats. I already kind of mentioned this a little bit, but I loved what Claire said. You know, you want to give your supporters, your fundraisers, a compelling and uplifting story to share with the donors they're reaching out to. Because stories are what connect us. Like I mentioned before, I was in the dream-making business. We create opportunities for kids to dream again. But when we put stories behind that, where we talked about a little boy named Samson who lived in the Himalayas in Nepal and had an unfortunate accident where he was injured and was stuck in a wheelchair. But a kind group of people, both people on the ground and supporters and donors, were able to come together to give Samson the opportunity to receive medical attention and medical care. And even though that's what we were doing, the real story was that Samson, a boy that was destined to be forgotten or left to the side because of a devastating injury, had the opportunity to imagine a new future. And not just Samson, but I saw Samson's dad. I met him And he was so grateful because even through Samson's story and the care and love that he received, his dad was impacted and saw the world in a new and different way. And Samson's story is something that encapsulates all the work that our organization did, even though we helped millions of people and we did a bunch of different things. But Samson's story is what was the vehicle or the packaging or the wrapping that we were able to communicate to other people and connect with. Stories are what connect us. And when you walk away today, you're going to remember Corinne's story or maybe David's story because those resonate with you. You're going to think about Chris and Will like I am all the time, where I have three boys. And I'm like, man, Chris and Will remind me of what I hope to have an opportunity with my children through a shared passion to be able to celebrate and serve others. This is the stories that connect us. And so your organization's most important asset when you're thinking about peer-to-peer is you want to lead with stories, not stats. World Bicycle Relief, which is one of the organization Claire works at that I just shared that quote from, she leads a community of advocates and people that are just supporters. These aren't paid individuals that have raised millions of dollars over the past few years on their behalf. But they focus on equipping these supporters with this idea of a story, the power of you, but also the power of a single story. And so they want to connect this idea that you as an individual and a person that is being mobilized through their support and their services, that encompasses everything. And they really do this incredibly well. I'll send some links to their peer-to-peer fundraising site so you can see it. They've been with us empowering their peer-to-peer with CauseVox for years now, but they do an incredible job at really telling beautiful stories through multimedia. And they focus on this idea of stories of one. And the importance of stories of one, like I mentioned with Samson, is that stories of one are easier and designed to be shared, which is one of the other pro tips that we see organizations that do peer-to-peer well, is that they lead with stories, but they've designed those stories in a way that they're really easy to be shared. So a lot of times when we're communicating as a nonprofit, we're sending out a message to one. So we're sending a message from us to them. And we're designing the story to invoke a response or to inspire or to activate or to rally the person that's going to be receiving this. But the organizations that take it to the next level design any communication because all your communication should be story driven or story focused to be shared on, because they see in today's connected economy that the real power, which is what is the backbone of any peer-to-peer fundraising, is that your supporters, the people that you're communicating with as an organization, are going to share on that story. And so when they're thinking about how they design stories, they're designing them to be shared. And the power in telling stories of one, like this idea of this little boy in the Himalayan mountains who had a devastating injury and was left to be forgotten, is that his story, this story of one, encompasses the story of many others. However, you can take Samson's story and easily share that on. You might even remember it as you go throughout the rest of your week and think about Samson. Or again, maybe about David's story and how he wanted to advocate for a cause he deeply believed in. These are the stories that are designed to be shared and ultimately make it easier for you to tap in to peer-to-peer fundraising. So the next peer-to-peer tactic that really is kind of encased in this idea of inspiration over guilt is being cause-centered, not organization-centered, in all of your messaging. And so ultimately, your organization is the conduit or is part of, in some way, depending on your organization's mission, as the organization that's doing the good or helping to facilitate the good. And it's easy for a lot of that to boil down into our communication. Or when we communicate with others, we focus on talking about what we as an organization are doing, rather than the outcome or the cause that we're advocating for or that we're fighting for or the mission that we're fighting for. To go back to the local example with a local like private school here, they can talk a lot about how they're helping kids, they're really excited, they have some new programmings, they're trying to expand their school so they can invite more kids in. That's not really the cause. The cause is that they fundamentally believe that a certain type of education and education style and kind of classroom presentation and these environments that create opportunities to learn are going to create our next leaders in our community, whether it's in politics or nonprofits or government or business. They believe that that environment is really doing that. That's the cause. They're trying to invest in the next generation. And so leading with that as the why behind their organization is going to be more effective because, again, that's what people are buying into, not just what your organization's doing. They want to be a part of, because you can get behind a cause. You can't get behind an organization. An organization is a group of people that are behind a cause. And so as you communicate to your supporters, you want to invite them in to be focused on the cause. And your organization is the conduit, the channel, the boat, for lack of a better word, that they're going to use to invest in whatever this cause is. I think this organization brings a little coloring to that idea. Vola City Kids Foundation is really about investing in children. They use a lot of sports and whatnot to really invest in underserved youth and bringing different types of children together around this idea of play, but ultimately so that they can help children thrive, or in this case, triumph. And so they ran a campaign a couple years ago where they really focused on this idea that they wanted to showcase and rally or inspire people to get behind this idea that so every child can. And they had a bunch of different words that they put in there. And I love this because it sparks an emotional response. It's inspirational, inspires people to get involved. And they did a great job at doing that. The last one in this section is this idea of showcasing impact, not your organization's work. And so there's this idea about being cause-centered, not organization-centered. And this is a little bit different. And so what this is focusing on is not just talking about what the work your organization's doing, but rather showcasing the outcome of what your organization's doing. Or in some cases, when you're doing fundraising, you have to actually showcase what the outcome would be if your organization didn't exist. Because that's also an effective way to inspire people. By saying, if we together do not step in this moment, this is what will happen. So showcasing impact isn't always about the positive outcomes or the success outcomes. It also could be the negative outcomes of your organization's work. Because again, that is going to inspire people and it's going to give people the opportunity to be a part of, not merely give to an organization, which ultimately enhances the opportunity for individuals to fundraise on your behalf. Jay, the founder and CEO at Endure to Cure, which is one of our customers here at Causevox, said, share exactly who benefited from each person's fundraising and how, when possible. Even take this to the next level by sharing the story of exactly what child, family, or whomever the beneficiary is of your work, benefit from the fundraising and what assistance they'll receive before the team member starts fundraising. You're equipping individuals with ammo, for lack of a better word, to go out and really be effective at fundraising. Because they now know the impact that they are able to have if they are successful. So they know what they're trying to accomplish. And in some cases, like I mentioned, you can showcase the impact if you're not successful. And that's also motivating and inspiring. So ultimately, focus on this idea foundationally in your messaging, in your fundraising, that you want to inspire people, stories over stats, cause over organization, and impact over your organization's output. Those are all ways that you can focus on inspiring people. Again, fundamentally just builds an opportunity for you to be more successful with peer-to-peer fundraising because you're equipping people with something that is easier for them to share and get behind and inviting them to be a part of, not merely give to. So the next section is this idea of activate over convince. And I already mentioned that this idea of activation, like a runner, is set to go. They have potential. They're just waiting for that gun to go off so that they'll start the race. And in the same way, organizations that are successful at peer-to-peer fundraising, what we've observed is that they also communicate in that way. They assume, they lead with that people have the potential and want to be a part of or more engaged with their cause. And so again, this is embedded in their messaging, their communication, and their strategy. So let's unpack that a little bit more. The first peer-to-peer tactic we see successful organizations do around activation is that they start before they start. And Jake, who's actually on this webinar training right now, put it this way. You know, think of a launch of a peer-to-peer campaign the same way you would launch a capital campaign. You wouldn't release a campaign to the public to raise $20 million for your new building with $0 in the coffers and no backers. So why take that same approach with peer-to-peer? And ultimately, I think what this quote encapsulates is this idea that peer-to-peer fundraising, it's really important for you to do research ahead of time, whether it's identifying your audience or understanding how this is going to fit into your organization. Additionally, it's about not just rolling this out as an all hands on deck organizational wide supporter based opportunity, but rather identifying people that can be early adopters or piloting the program. One organization that did this really well, which I'll share, is they piloted peer to peer with their staff and with their board of directors. Because they felt like if they could figure out a way to get their staff and their board of directors to successfully run fundraising campaigns, you know, with the help of Cosbox and our platform to be able to facilitate all of that, then they would learn a lot in an environment that was much safer or much had much less risk because they weren't bringing, you know, real supporters and real donors into the fold. They would learn how they could better support other fundraisers. Whereas other organizations that when they start a peer-to-peer fundraising campaign, they want to have some early adopters. So they want to target people earlier and get them on board before they roll out the campaign to the public. So when people, the broader audience, gets excited about this opportunity and comes in to learn more or to engage with your peer-to-peer fundraising campaign, they already see others that they could model after. Humans are funny. You know, we're always asking the question, do people like me do things like this? And this idea of starting before you start really sets the tone that you're giving some beacons, some anchors in your campaign that people can look at, people can reference. And so this start before you start really embodies two different things. One is starting small so that you can learn and grow and figure out how to effectively use peer-to-peer within your organization's culture and with your organization's supporter base and audience. But also in the same way, when you actually roll out campaigns, having some early adopters is really essential because that's going to allow people, your other supporters who come in to want to learn more, not to feel like they're the first at a party. Not many people like being first at the party, and they want to know, do people like me do things like this? And if so, how? And that's what starting before you start really allows you to do well. So the next peer-to-peer tactic we really want to dive into is this idea of segment always. So peer-to-peer is not for everyone. And we share a lot with nonprofits that are thinking about peer-to-peer or they've done peer-to-peer in the past, but really haven't invested well in it and are talking to us because they want to adopt our platform because they think our technology will really help them implement this. And the first thing they want to do is roll this out to their entire supporter base because they're just excited about the opportunity, the potential that of finding the Corinne and the David in their community to go out and raise $15,000, $20,000 for them and acquire 100 donors. However, what we've seen time and time again is that organizations that are successful think well before they invite people to be a peer-to-peer fundraiser. They want to understand the context of the relationship that they have with those supporters. There are certain individuals in your community that are probably better fit for peer-to-peer fundraising just because of their influence, their status, their engagement with your organization. First-time donors, maybe not the best person to ask. If they just gave, maybe not the best time. It's going to be different for your organization, but this idea about segmentation when you're thinking about who to invite to peer-to-peer is crucial because it's not for everyone. So this organization is a great example. Like, I just went to their conference last week, N10, Nonprofit Technology Network, and there was 2,500 people there, vendors, consultants, nonprofit pros, a bunch of do-gooders, all the environment. And all of those people are a part of their community. They've been doing this for 11 or 12 years now. And it's just incredible to see how big of a community they have as a part of their conference. But when they started thinking about peer-to-peer, what they did was they wanted to focus on just activating their board members, those who deeply believed in the organization's mission and also had influence, had networks, and were excited to use those networks to promote the cause that this organization was advocating for, which is education, training, community, conversations between various do-gooders in different roles that are all trying to push change forward in their unique and different ways. And so they segment it and say, hey, we're going to ask our board members to do this. And so that's how, that's an example of how you can segment always with peer-to-peer and ultimately drive more success, because you can customize your message more specifically, your invitations on when you're reaching out to individuals. All of that's really important to helping you drive success with peer-to-peer. The next peer-to-peer tactic that we learned when we were really diving into this, and this is, you know, we sell software here at Cosvox, but a lot of our audience said that we reached out to it and said, hey, what's driving your success? And they were like, we chose the right platform. And we believe that we need a good platform partner, a good fundraising software. It's key, as Caroline put it. She said, if you're working with a product that is limited, you're going to have limited results. And the thing is that you may make a lot of software decisions or vendor decisions or partner decisions as a part of kind of the regular cadence of your nonprofit. But very few of them are directly going to influence your supporters. Whereas when you have a peer-to-peer fundraising software, or you're trying to promote people to go out and fundraise on your behalf, the decision you make with the platform you have is going to highly impact the experience that your supporters have. And so regardless of whether you have a good tool now or not, it is considering, just because it's good enough, is it good enough for what you want to showcase to your supporters? We hear time and time again, when people switch to Cosvox from another provider of peer-to-peer fundraising software, they always talk about the reason they're switching is because the experience that their supporters had when they tried to go fundraise was not good. They had a lot of hiccups. They had a lot of technical issues. People couldn't even get through the process. And so ultimately, it was more of a headache and discouraging to individuals that wanted to be a fundraiser than really successful. And ultimately, if people can't set up their page, if they can't promote it, if people can't donate easily, all of the efforts and investments that you're making in peer-to-peer fundraising goes to waste. And so one of the key tactics of people that are successful with peer-to-peer is they pick a platform that is designed for them, like Taka did, and Cosvox really supports to help. This is a powered by Cosvox campaign, where they're able to brand it. It's all about them, white labeled, so that their supporters see Taka and not some third party website. They're not sending them out to Facebook to do fundraising on their behalf. They're saying, hey, we want to invite you to be a part of this. They're activating successfully, and that's crucial when you're running a successful peer-to-peer campaign. They also want to make sure the experience is super seamless. Like, you're inviting someone into a vulnerable experience in anyways. And so any friction in the process is going to discourage people and ultimately turn people away. This is similar to your online donation page. It's the same way. You don't want people to experience something that is going to turn them off or create friction, which is going to prevent them from joining and being a part of it. You also want to make it easy to share. And ultimately, when their supporters come in and say, hey, I'm inspired, I want to get behind this, how easy is it to give? And Cosvox is designed specifically around these things, because when we look at the research, those are the things that matter most. When we ask people, those are the things that matter most. We want it to be purposely simple, we want it to be designed for us, and we want it to be super easy to share and engage across a variety of devices. So these are all super important things. Whether you choose Cosvox or not, it's important to understand what matters, because it's going to impact your supporters' experience. So the last thing we'll talk about here in this section is this idea of keeping it personal. When you're trying to activate someone to go out and fundraise on your behalf, it's important to how you're presenting that opportunity, whether it's through email or maybe at an event or even through a direct mail piece or even a one-on-one conversation, is you want to make sure that you keep it personal. Peer-to-peer fundraising success really boils down to communication. And so it's important to understand that when you reach out to your supporters and invite them to fundraise on your behalf, it's a very personal thing that you're asking them to do. It's actually easier for them to give you money directly out of their wallet, here's 20 bucks, than to take a step out on a limb and say, hey, I want to be an advocate for you. I'm going to pledge to raise $1,000 on your behalf. Or like Corinne did, where she was like, I'm going to be brave. I'm going to use my story and my son's story and kind of how this organization played into it as a way to showcase and inspire others to get behind that. That's a vulnerable thing. And so it's important when you reach out to people, when you're sending emails, it's very personal. Example of this is the Motherhood Collective. They struggled for years to do traditional fundraising, but they focused on this idea that they had 200 volunteers that were on the front lines every single day or every single week in variety of capacities, seeing directly the impact that their organization was having. So they decided to focus really in on this idea of how do we make sure that we invite them to do different things. So they started doing this in the month of May. First year they raised 7,000, next year they raised 24, this year, or in 2018, they almost raised 40,000. And so through this idea of where they were being personal, they were inspiring people instead of guilt, they were activating people, they were able to see a continual growth in their peer-to-peer fundraising year over year. And really it was because they just had more people in their community feeling comfortable and seeing that people like me do things like this, which helped them really scale up their fundraising efforts. Jake, Director of Operations at Mortgage Professionals Providing Hope, said, from helping them see the impact of their work, they're helping to support, to make them feel supported and encouraged, to equipping them to become an effective fundraiser. Nothing has yielded better results than assigning liaisons to, if you will, to each fundraiser who elects to support her cause. While technology can help reinforce a personalized approach, it can't replace it. And so even though we're a software company, we still see the value in a one-to-one human relationship. Fundraising has always been people to people. Technology just helps enhance and scale that. So the last section we're going to talk about, and then we're going to take some questions, is this idea of rally versus control. And I've already talked a lot about this at the beginning, but it's really this idea of how do you, once someone starts fundraising for you, really support them well. And so the first thing that we see in organizations that really do this is they equip fundraisers to be successful. They come alongside them and support them. They provide them with resources. These fundraisers that you're inviting, these supporters you're inviting to do fundraising for you, they're not paid to fundraise. They're not professional fundraisers. And so it's important to provide some resources and training, similar to how you're attending this training because you want to be better at your job. You can also do the same for people that come into your organization and want to fundraise on your behalf. So one organization that does this well, even though it's amongst many, is they provide a fundraising toolkit, a simple document that really just kind of outlines the expectations. Think of it like a new employee handbook where you're saying, hey, this is how you do this. Like, welcome. Thank you for being a part of this. I want to provide you a blueprint for how you can be successful, a plan that sets expectations, provides recommendations, and gives you some sort of idea that you're here now at the start, but this is where you're headed. Some ideas on how to be successful. Talking about first thing first. It's kind of like on your first day of work, it's always important to tell people where the bathroom is. And same thing in peer-to-peer. You really want to make sure that you're being clear. You're here today. This is how things are going. And this is where you're going from here. And providing some examples so that they can see how they can get from where they are, which is ground zero, to a place of success. And helping them almost see that success before they ever even achieve it, which is essential in kind of equipping people well to be successful. The second thing is that you want to be a support and an encouragement. Jessica talks about this. She says, remembering that your peer-to-peer fundraisers have different levels of comfort asking for money, it's your responsibility. You want to help them get over the hump. And so Baycat does this in a lot of different ways, by really focusing on this idea of supporting their Baycat champions and even just respecting them and acknowledging that they're doing something that is different and uncomfortable, but they're going out and supporting them. You know, they have a dedicated contact person. You know, they're sending an email to new people saying, hey, thank you so much for joining. Let me introduce you to some of the other people that are doing this. There's a lot of different ways that you can be an incredible support. And ultimately, the organizations that are successful at peer-to-peer or community-driven fundraising are the ones that embody all of these efforts. But I think this is the idea of rallying or being a support and equipping your supporters well is one that's overlooked and often missed. And I think it's the one that has the highest return on your investment, because once you get someone so far down the pipeline that they're saying, hey, I want to be an advocate for you, leaving them out to dry or to explore it like the Western frontier is not going to yield the results that they had hoped for, thus impacting their experience, and they're less likely to come back and do this again. So really coming alongside them, first equipping them, and second supporting them, is essential in being a successful organization at peer-to-peer fundraising. Jay, again, says, Be outwardly helpful without being overwhelming. Inform your fundraisers about your cause, your programs, your impact, and so on in a simple, easy to understand ways. And there's a lot of things that we talked about in the inspire over guilt section that you can embody and encompass, or incorporate into how you educate, how you train, and how you really support and equip your fundraisers to be successful. You're giving them stories, you're giving them videos, you're teaching them, you know, about your organization so that they can speak on behalf of the cause. What are you fighting for? Why does that matter? If your organization didn't exist, who would care? Those types of things are really important and often overlooked. The last thing we'll kind of mention here is this idea that to be successful at rallying your fundraisers, you want to celebrate everything. And as Jake said, every campaign isn't going to be a wild success. Every fundraiser isn't going to hit their goal. And every person sharing their campaign isn't always going to get the messaging quite right. But you have to be ready to celebrate everything. And I think a great organization, or an organization that does this really well, is Amigos International. They really come along their supporters, both volunteers, board members, others that are fundraising on their behalf, and kind of just celebrate them. They even send emails out to other fundraisers when new fundraisers join. And they've even gone to the extent that they've promoted a fundraiser's campaign to their entire support base, because they were so excited about the story and how well someone's story encapsulated what this organization was all about, that they shared that with their broader community and said, hey, this person really gets it and understands it, and we want to recognize that. And so celebrating everything from when someone signs up to when they start getting their first donation to when they hit their goal or to when they miss their goal, every opportunity is an opportunity to reaffirm your appreciation for them. Junior Achievement also does this really well, where they actually have a corporate peer-to-peer fundraising campaign, where they reach out to their corporate partners in the DC area and invite them to invite their staff to fundraise on their behalf, which is a very vulnerable thing, where they coordinate trainings, they provide resources, and even create co-branded fundraising sites using CauseVox. Right here, you see KPMG, where they can give this organization a site that's co-branded. And they create friendly competition with the leadership board and even badges and awards. And so again, this idea of celebration is really essential to successful peer-to-peer fundraising. And ultimately, as a pro tip, you just want to be grateful and delighted that people are fundraising on your behalf. Jay again shared, your fundraisers are a valuable extension of your brand and your development, so treat them well and not like a fundraising commodity. People join your cause because they want to make a positive difference for your programs. People want to be a part of something bigger than themselves. Prove the difference they are making and show them how grateful you are for their efforts. Happy, delighted fundraisers will promote you to others and or stay involved. And these are the key things here. This is what's going to drive success and help you be successful at peer-to-peer fundraising. So these tips, tactics, lessons that we've really garnered after studying thousands of campaigns raising millions have led us to develop this framework. And we believe this framework, as we mentioned, is going to help you really crush it at peer-to-peer fundraising, because you're laying a foundation that's going to help you drive success and really activate your supporters to raise more money for your cause. And this isn't just about having the knowledge to do this, but it's also important that you have the right tools and the platform and the hands-on help. And that's what we do here at CauseVox every day. The examples we shared today are successful because they have the right ideas, the right framework, but they're also using a platform that they can lean on and know that they're supported by our experienced team here at CauseVox. So individuals like Corinne, who was able to fundraise and raise tons of money on behalf of TACA by sharing her story, that was powered by CauseVox. Chris and Will's campaign, which raised thousands and thousands of dollars on behalf of World Bicycle Relief, ultimately impacted 263 people. Chris and Will and their community helped 263 people. That was powered by CauseVox. And even David's campaign to really leverage his network to amplify the cause he so deeply cared about, Glad was using CauseVox to power that experience.